Say, I had said it already during the prayer. I said amen again.
Amen.
All right. Father right there must have something that I didn't know about. That's right. He mentioned in his prayer the reason for the season, and he mentioned it twice. Right? So I'm going to just jump ahead of my game plan. If I can get my scribe, Shanuka, to go ahead and write the title of the lesson, Brother Duncan had mentioned in his prayer the reason for the season. Can you go put up the title? My scribe's gonna help me out. It was nice to involve the young folk in the service. Also in the prayer, Brother Duncan had mentioned about our hearts and our minds and being focused, right? And in this idea of the season of joy and peace. Right? Let's just take a moment to just say hi to your fellow neighbors while we're getting our minds focused. Just say hi to your neighbor, and you know, hi, how was your holiday and all that, right? Okay? Get yourself loosened up, right? Oh, we're getting good. Okay? All right. I have to get loosened up. You know, machines don't always work right. And normally I print out my lesson, I couldn't print it. Not working, so I have to do this thing with my computer, so hopefully it works out. Reason for the season. Season's greetings to everybody, right? And not everybody in the world recognizes season's greetings. To them, this hypothetical phrase that we use, season's greeting, is not talking about winter, spring, summer, or fall. It's talking about this other season. It's talking about a different season, but not everybody around the world recognizes this phrase that Christians use, season's greetings, right? There's a season in this hypothetical phrase, season's greetings, about joy and peace, and many words come to your mind. A whole gamut of words comes to our mind when we use this phrase, season's greetings. And you know that cartoon about the Grinch? Cartoon that comes on TV about, you know, the whole city is about embracing this phrase, season's greetings. So they've got joy and peace and stuff like that. But there's one guy lives high up in the hill called the Grinch, right? He's going all bah humbug, but he is not involved himself in this phrase, right? So hopefully everybody here has this mindset of this phrase, embrace the season, season's greetings, okay? All right. If I can get Chinooka under the title, A Reason for the Season, put the subtitle, Setting Aside a Day to Celebrate the Birth of Christ, right? Subtitle, I'm gonna talk about for the next few minutes, try to keep it short as possible, but to help you to focus, as per our prayer on the lesson, and it may be a blessing to you. You can always look about what I'm talking about with the subtitles. Setting aside a day to celebrate the birth of Christ. And as I already alluded, there are many people around the world that do not even recognize or celebrate this thing about the birth of Christ. There are some people that their mindset isn't even wrapped around it, all right? There are some people that embrace this phrase called season's greetings, right? But they embrace it for all the wrong reasons. So there are some people that don't embrace it. There are some people that embrace it, but embrace it for all the wrong reasons, right? And nothing really bad about these reasons, but really it's not the true focus of this, the meaning of this phrase, season's greetings. You know, they missed the whole point. I got in my notes here that they're so caught up. Their point about the season's greetings part, about this season, is about holidays. You know, around this time of year, a lot of people take vacations, right? They have time off work. There are many employers that shut down their businesses just so that you can have this holiday, right? But there are some people, there are a lot of people that focus the season's greetings on the holiday. They focus on bonuses. Many employers, they do their year ends. And when they have a good year, they, out of the kindness of their heart, they might say, hey, instead of putting all the excess profits that I made as the business owner, what they do is say, hey, I'm gonna give some to the people that help to make the business strong. And they give out these things called bonuses. But some people are focused on the bonuses. Some people are focused on not only holidays, but people take their families away on vacations and they have trips. Some people are just focused on that. The whole meaning, reason for the season is based on their vacations or parties. You know, employers have parties, families have parties, nothing wrong with having parties. But a lot of times the main focus, the point is being missed, the true point. But that point is about the parties. Or, you know that thing called eggnog? I didn't have none this year. Eggnog, things that happen around this time of year. Do you ever have eggnog in the summertime?
Not really.
July? Around Christmas time, around December time, and eggnog, right? Or some people get caught up in shopping. And shopping's a wonderful thing. Everybody likes to go shopping, right? But the main focus is on shopping. The business is about the bottom line. There are people that have executives that sit in big offices, and their whole point, their whole career is focused on their bottom line. How can they make more money this year than they made last year? Or they'll go through the whole 12 months of the year. But the biggest time for making the most profit is around this time. And the focus is on their bottom line. Or the focus, some people's focus is on receiving things. You know, around this time of year, people give a lot to charities and things. They give from their heart, right? Because joy and peace in their heart. So people are more giving. I don't know why, but hey, that's the spirit. That's the spirit that's in the season, right? But people are caught up on the receiving part, right? Receiving part. Some people like to cook. You know, we were talking about that in the class. That, you know, you had good meals the last couple of days, right? Some people get caught up in the meals and cooking part of it, and it's good, right? But their focus is on the meals. A lot of people clean up their house and do all types of cleaning. I mean, I know in businesses, they do a lot of cleaning around this time of the year. They, all the excess stuff, they sort of throw things away and they make the accepted business to be a little more streamlined, right? But then there are people that are Christians and they embrace season's greetings to the birth of Christ, to the birth of Christ. Birth of Christ. Now, biblically speaking, we are not commanded to observe the birth of Christ. But me, I celebrate my birthday when I was born every year. Every year I recognize that I was born. I celebrate certain things in my life. I celebrate my birthday. There are things that I did, great things in my memory. And when those things come to my mind, I sort of have a smile in my face. Sometimes there are things I have certificates for that I've done in the past. And when I look at them, I say, yeah, I came first there, or I accomplished that. I have trophies at home. There are things that I celebrate. There are things that I celebrate, right? And I mark those things that bring happiness for those accomplishments, right? And if you're a true human being, if you have any type of accomplishment in your life, it's just your human nature to celebrate those things, whether it's a memory. You know, when people have a birthday in our congregation, we mark to make that person feel good. We sing happy birthday to them, right? Yeah, I mean, one sister tried to sneak it past me, right? She tried to sneak it past me. But I got her singing happy birthday. So there are Christians that focus on season's greetings, but they focus on the birth of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
All right. The reason for the season. If I can get my scribe, Shinoka, to put up the next subtitle, Sin. The reason for the season, I'm going to put up on the board. Shinoka's going to put up on the board. The reason for the season is this thing called sin. We can get caught up on all the things that the world lays out on the table about this season. They might have Christmas trees, all sorts of stuff. The world might put out Yule logs. They might put out all sorts of sales at the stores. You ever heard of Black Friday? All types of things, right? Shopping and all that thing, right? But the real reason for the season is this thing called sin, right? Sin is anything that's contrary to God's word, right? Way back in your mind, right? If you can think about in Genesis, in your Bible, the Bible teaches about Adam and Eve being in the Garden of Eden, right? And that's where sin entered the world. And sin separates you from God, right? Sin is what separates you from God, because God is perfect and man is sinful. Back in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve were in the garden, and God told them, he told them not to partake of the tree of good and evil, tree of life, right? And guess what they did? They brought sin into the world by being disobedient to God's word. Anything contrary to God's word is sin. And they brought sin into the world. And what God had to do was he separate himself from their sin. He cast Adam and Eve out of the Garden of Eden. And it's because of that one act that is the reason for the season. Amen? It's the reason for the season. And Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, I encourage you to go there. You might know it, but I want you to turn to Romans chapter 6 and verse 23. If we're really going to focus on the lesson of all the elements of putting it up on the board and God's written word, I want you to turn to Romans chapter 6, verse 23. We're talking about sin. And to make this interactive, can I get a reader for that? Romans 6, verse 23.
Nice and loud. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Way in the Garden of Eden, sin separated man from God. Right? So the wages of sin, the payment for sin is death. But there's a gift. The reason for the season is that the gift of God is eternal life. That is a life without sin. Through what? Through Jesus Christ our Lord. We have to recognize if we're going to embrace the reason for the season, is to focus. The real reason is because this thing called sin. If it wasn't for sin, we wouldn't need the reason for the season. We wouldn't need this gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, because we wouldn't be separated from God in the first place. But it's because of this thing that happened in the Garden of Eden, sin entered the world. And the wages of sin is death. That is the reason for the season. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Can I get my scribe, Shinova, to help us to focus on the lesson? If I can get the next subtitle, redemption. Redemption. If sin entered the world and Adam and Eve were cast out of the Garden of Eden, it was at that time that God already had a redemption plan in his mind. He had in his mind a plan to bring back man into the right relationship with God, right? Redemption. In the days of Noah, I know you might know, I've heard the story of Noah and the ark. In the days of Noah, the world was full of wickedness. The world was full of wickedness. And God repented that he even made man, because man was so wicked. But he found grace in Noah, this guy named Noah. And he instructed God on Noah to build this ark. And it took Noah decades to build this ark. And he preached to the people, these wicked people, that they need to come into this ark. And you know the story of Noah and the ark. But when the floods came, the eight sails was saved by the ark. It was God's plan for redemption in motion. In motion. He destroyed all the people in the earth except for those eight souls through the ark that Noah built. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. Turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. Can I get Shinova to put right next to redemption? Abraham. If you turn in Genesis chapter 22 and verse 15, you know the story of Abraham, where God spoke to Abraham and said, get thee out of this land And Abraham left his land and went to a different land that he didn't even know where he was going. And go to Abraham, who didn't have any children, that he was going to have a child. And he even laughed at God, sort of, him and his wife. Say, how can I have a child and I'm ill, right? And you know the story of Abraham when he didn't quite have the full understanding of what was going on. And he even had a child by his what? Housemaid? Hagar, right?
Handmaid, right?
But that wasn't a promised seed. But after that, the story goes on to say where his wife Sarah had a son named who? Isaac, right? And at one time, God instructed Abraham to take his son Isaac up into the mountain. And the angel of the Lord told Abraham to take his son and to sacrifice him, right? And the story goes on to say, this is all the plan of redemption. It goes on to say that when Abraham was full of faith and he was going to do what the angel of the Lord told him to do, he was going to strike his son down, his only begotten son. He was going to kill his son because God told him to do so, right? In Genesis chapter 15, the Bible says, in your Bible it says, and the angel of the Lord called unto Abraham out of heaven the second time and said, by myself have I sworn, saith the Lord, for because thou hast done this thing and have not withheld thy son, thine only son, that in blessing I will bless thee, and in multiplying I will multiply what? I will multiply thy seed. Whose seed? Abraham's seed. As the stars of the heaven, and as the sand which is upon the seashore, and thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemy. We did a whole lesson last year about the gates of hell, right? The gates of hell, right? And thy seed shall possess the gate of his enemies. And in thy seed shall what? All nations of the earth be blessed, because thou hast obeyed my voice. It's important to note that the angel of the Lord said, I will bless and multiply thy seed, the seed of Abraham, right? And what? All nations of the earth shall be blessed. Talking about redemption, God's working out his redemption process even through Abraham, through his seed. He said he's going to multiply his seed and all nations shall be of the earth shall be blessed. Talking about God's redemption for man. Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden, and he was separated from God. God's work, plan of redemption was through the Jews in Egyptian bondage. But all through the stream of time, through the Old Testament, happened. And these Jews who were in Egyptian bondage, they knew in their head that there was a deliverer that was going to come. And they knew that through the prophets. And they were waiting for a deliverer from Egyptian bondage. And the Bible depicts this lady called Jochebed. And that was the mother of Moses. And at that time, the Pharaoh of the land, they were killing all the male babies. And at that time, history reveals that there were nations like those who were under Jewish bondage, they would have so many people that were multiplying, they were having babies, that the rulers, the Egyptians, were being fearful because there were so many Jews. So they instituted a law where they would kill all the male babies. But Jochebed loved her son Moses so much that, as the story goes, in his redemption plan that God instituted, was she put her son Moses into a basket and set it amongst the reeds in the Nile River. And Moses' older sister, Miriam, followed this basket, right? It's an operation of God. You don't believe in miracles? It's an operation of God. And this basket floated right past Pharaoh's house. And Pharaoh's sister found the basket. And Miriam, with all her boldness, went over to Pharaoh's daughter and asked the daughter of Pharaoh, I mean, the sister of Pharaoh, could she find somebody to nurse the baby? And she got Mary went and got her mother, which was actually Joseph's mother. And the daughter, the sister of Pharaoh actually paid Moses' mother to take care of Moses. That's operation of God, amen?
Amen.
Talking about redemption, all right? Redemption. When Moses grew up in the house of Pharaoh, right? House of Pharaoh, he had a choice that he made to follow as a prince of Pharaoh or to choose righteousness. And it was a hard decision for him, but it was easy because he chose his bloodline of being one of God's people. No, after he found out that he wasn't the son of Pharaoh, but he was the son of this lady called Jochebed. And as the story goes, that Moses was cast out of the land of Egypt, and he came back, and he became a deliverer of those Jews that were in Egyptian bondage. Amen? Turn in your Bibles to Galatians chapter 3, verse 23. We're talking about the redemption. I know of your sin, the wages of sin is death. But God has a plan of redemption, even in the Old Testament through Moses. In Galatians chapter 3 and verse 23, under the Old Testament law, where Moses led the Israelites out of Egyptian bondage, they traveled through the wilderness for 40 years. Amen? And they came across this place called Mount Sinai. And God called Moses up into the mountain, and he came down off the mountain with two tables of stone. And on those two tables of stone was the Old Testament law. It was the Old Testament law, right? In Galatians chapter 3 and verse 23, the Bible says, "But before faith came, we were kept under the law, shut up unto faith, which should come afterwards, which should afterwards be revealed." When Moses came off the Mount Sinai with those two tables of stone, they were the Old Testament law. The Jews followed those laws to a T. They followed those laws to a T. But those laws that they followed wasn't according to faith. It was according to works. They had to do what they were instructed to do. And it didn't take faith to do that law. It took just doing. But faith, the Bible teaches in Galatians chapter 2 and verse 23, "But faith came, but before faith came, we were under the law." Those Jews were under the law. They were shut up unto faith, which should afterwards be revealed. Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by what?
Faith.
By faith, all right? The law wasn't by faith, right? They were shut up unto faith until Christ, amen? Wherefore the law was our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after that faith is come, we are no longer under the schoolmaster. God had a redemption plan in process, even when Moses led the Israelites and became Jews, and they were under the Old Testament law. God had a plan for man, but the plan wasn't fulfilled until Christ came. Amen? The reason for the season, we're going to have in our mind the reason for the season is, we got to have in our mind that the reason for the season is everything pointed towards Christ and through faith. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
If I put another, like to have in your minds, is even the Old Testament law pointed to Christ, that the Redeemer was coming. But there were also prophets, prophecies. And these prophets pointed to Jesus. Everything they spoke of God from God's words was pointing to Jesus, and they actually did things, and he spoke about miracles. Those prophets actually did miracles that confirmed God, right? And they they prophesized that this Savior, that this Redeemer, that this King, that a new law will come into effect, that there will be a new kingdom, and that there will be better promises. Turn in your Bible to Jeremiah chapter 31 and verse 31. We're talking about the reason for the season. The reason for the season. It's all because of sin. But it's also about redemption. Amen? In Jeremiah chapter 31 and verse 31, the Bible says, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my law in what? In their inward part." Remember, Moses came off the mount with two tables of stone, and the children of Israel carried those stones around in this thing called the Ark. You ever heard of the Ark of the Covenant? And only certain people could actually touch this ark. If not, they would die, right? But in the New Testament, Jeremiah is prophesying that I will put a new law in their inward parts, and I will write it in their hearts. It's almost like this ark in the Old Testament, this Ark of the Covenant, was like it was the heart of God. It was what God wanted them to do, right? And only certain people could touch it. Well, imagine something being written in your heart. Can anybody touch it? Whatever you have in your heart, do you think anybody could touch it? I will write my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. This is all pointing to something. It's all pointing to something. Jeremiah is pointing to this law that's going to be in the inward hearts of man, right? "And they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them unto the greatest of them, saith the Lord. And what? I will forgive their iniquity," or "I will forgive their sin." Remember the whole reason for the season is sin? This is Jeremiah prophesying at this time, coming in the future, "I will forgive their iniquity, their sin, and I will remember their sin no more." The reason for the season. Reason for the season. In Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6, can you all turn there? I know you've heard this in school plays. You've heard it on TV around this time of the year. But we're going to read from God's Word. Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6. It says, "For unto us a child is born." We're talking about Jesus here. This is Isaiah the prophet. It's prophesying about Jesus. "For unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given," the Son of God. "And the government shall be upon his shoulder." I know every country has a government. You know, there's 195 different countries around the world, and each country has its own government. It's not talking about that government. It's saying, "And the government shall be upon his shoulder." This is the government of the world. What controls not the country, but what controls the universe. "The government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor." What? I want everybody to say this. The mighty God. We're talking about Jesus, right? We all got to wrap our mind around, right? That Isaiah is depicting Jesus as what? The mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. There's something to celebrate. The reason for this season, we can celebrate the birth of Christ because it was something to be joyful about. Amen? And verse 7 it says, "And the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. Amen. I want to say thank you for Brother Kingsley Bright. You read Matthew chapter 1, the genealogy of Christ. God had a plan. God set in motion that genealogy, as your Bible depicts, each name in genealogy that led from Abraham, right to Christ. It was a chosen street genealogy, right? Reason for the season. If I get my scribes over to put the next subtitle, the birth of Christ. The birth of Christ. A reason for the season. You can't fully understand the reason for the season unless we understand that we have a sin problem and that God has a redemption plan. Everything in the Old Testament pointed to this redemption plan, Christ. Amen. And this Christ, according to the prophets of old time, that this Savior was coming, this Redeemer was coming, that the Son of God was coming, and he was going to bring peace, he was going to bring change, he was going to be a king, and he was going to redeem us. Amen? Turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 2, verse 6. Luke chapter 2, verse 6. We're going to fully understand the reason for this season and to be able in our mind to fully understand the celebration that Jesus was born in Bethlehem long ago. Luke chapter 2, and let's start at verse 4. Bible says, and Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth. Remember, you ever heard of Jesus of Nazareth? But that's where they lived. They lived in Nazareth, right? Into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem. How is Jesus from Nazareth? But he was born in Bethlehem. Isn't that kind of funny? Because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. The family lived in Nazareth, but they moved over to Bethlehem, which was far away. They moved over to Bethlehem for tax reasons. It says to be taxed with Mary because they were doing a consensus at that time. You can go down deeper into that part, but they moved from Nazareth, Jesus of Nazareth, because that's where they lived. But Jesus was born in Bethlehem, which was a totally different city, but they moved there for taxation purposes. Amen? Okay. In verse 7 it says, and she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid them in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Yeah, that's Bible for you. Nothing that's made up. This is real. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. Okay? Now, get the picture now. In the manger. Wasn't in the inn. Was Mary and Jesus, newborn baby, and Joseph was there, right? But also in the fields at night, there were shepherds, right? And get the story in your mind here. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon the shepherds, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were afraid, right? I'm talking about this, the Lord approaching the shepherds. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all the people. Not some of the people, it's not just for you, but if the angel of the Lord is going to show up to some shepherds and tell them that I bring good tidings of great joy, isn't that something to celebrate? Isn't that something to celebrate? Talking about the reason for the season. It goes on to say, for unto you is born this day in the city of David, Bethlehem, a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Savior, the Lord, right? That's something to get excited about. That's something to have joy about. If you're gonna have reason for the season, right? You gotta recognize and focus that the Christ, the Lord, was born on a certain day. We don't know what day it was. We don't know if it was July 1st, September 1st, October 31st. We don't know what day it is. But the world set aside a day to say, hey, we're just gonna recognize that this happened. We're gonna recognize this happened, all right? We don't know the day. And it goes on in verse 12 to say, and this shall be a sign unto you, ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling cloth, lying in the manger. And suddenly there was with the angel, what? A multitude of heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. Now it wasn't just one angel. But one angel was speaking to the shepherds. But then all of a sudden, a multitude of heavenly hosts praising God. God's worthy to be praised. This was something that was great, that bring great joy. There's nothing wrong with recognizing that Jesus was born, because that was the plan for God's plan for redemption. Amen? Redemption from sin. Verse 15, and it came to pass that the angels were gone away from them into heaven. The shepherds said one to another, let us now go even into Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. As they came with haste, they found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in the manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad that was in the area all around the saying which was told them concerning the child. They were so overjoyed with this good news that they went and spread the good news all around. Amen? The reason for the season. Can I get my scribe to help me out with another focus?
No, get my scribe should know about.
To put up John the Baptist. John the Baptist. I know Jesus. We know that Jesus was born in Bethlehem when he was a baby. But Jesus, like everybody, grows up, right? And God said in this plan of redemption about Jesus, around the same time Jesus was born, Jesus had a cousin as well, named John. In Mark chapter 1, you turn to Mark chapter 1, at verse 1, the Bible depicts John the Baptist as a forerunner for Christ. I mean, this news, this thing, this event that was going to happen was so big and so grand that all through the Old Testament lore, the prophets were prophesizing about this thing that was going to happen for hundreds of years. So big was this and grand was this thing that God even saw fit in his mind to have a forerunner. You know how in the world today, Hollywood would make a movie, but before they showed the movie, well, Christ, John the Baptist is like the preview to Christ. He's not Christ, but he's the one that gets you warmed up, gets you in the right frame of mind to accept what Christ has to offer. This thing, it's a great thing. There's nothing wrong with recognizing the reason for the season, all right? In Mark chapter 1, the Bible says, in the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Jesus Christ is the Son of God, amen? Anytime you have a doubt that Jesus Christ is not the Son of God, God, turn to Mark chapter 1 and start at verse 1. In the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophets, behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which what? Shall prepare thy way before thee. John had a purpose to prepare the people for the good news of Jesus. Amen. Verse 3 says, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. John did baptize in the wilderness and preach the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. In verse 7, the Bible goes on to say, and preach, saying, there cometh one mightier than I after me, the latchet of whose shoes I am not even worthy to stoop down and unloose. This is John the Baptist talking about Jesus. In verse 8 he says, I indeed baptize you with water, but he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. Amen. The story goes on where Jesus came unto John the Baptist, and John baptized Jesus. And Jesus went up, and the heavens opened up, and the Bible says in verse 10, the Spirit like a dove descended upon them, and there came a voice from heaven saying, Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. The reason for the season is Jesus being born, right, to fulfill all righteousness. Reason for the season, fulfill all righteousness. Can I get my scribe to help me with this lesson, reason for the season? Let's put up the next subtitle as I try to close this out. The ministry of Jesus. Jesus was born in the manger in Bethlehem. It was prophesied that he was going to come. But he grew up, and Jesus had a purpose. He had a work. He had a ministry. And one of the things that he did was he ran around and he taught the good news of the gospel. He was teaching the people things that they haven't heard before. Right? He was teaching them. And he also did miracles. We studied about miracles in the Bible class, about miracles. Jesus did miracles. And the purpose of the miracles, as the Bible depicts, the purpose of the miracles was not for Jesus to show off. The purpose of the miracles was for Jesus to, well, the miracles to confirm that Jesus was of God. Amen? Miracles. The ministry of Jesus. Also in the ministry of Jesus is he appointed apostles. He taught his apostles to be leaders, the leadership position that they may carry on with the teaching of the kingdom. Apostles. This was all part of Jesus' ministry. He also worked on spreading the good news of the gospel, and he had followers. That was the breakfast ministry. He ran into the highways and byways, and he taught up in the temples. He taught in people's homes, right? He had a ministry unto the followers. All those who would listen, he preached unto them. Amen? And as I already alluded to, Jesus' ministry was to fulfill all righteousness. Fulfill everything that was said that he would do, that was prophesied that this person would do, that's what Jesus did. Even the death of the cross. Even the death of the cross. He was to fulfill all righteousness. Amen? We're thinking about the reason for the season. We're not just thinking about our holidays, gifts, families, good things. They're all good things, right? We're thinking about the birth of the Savior. The birth of the Savior. In Acts chapter 3 and verse 24, the reason for the season. Acts chapter 3 and verse 24. The Bible says in verse 24, it says, yes, and all the prophets from Samuel and all those who follow, as many as have spoken, have also foretold of these days. You are the sons of the prophets and of the covenant which God made with our fathers, saying unto Abraham, and this is what he said unto Abraham, and in your seed all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Did we read that before? And I'll read it again. In your seed, talking to Abraham, in your seed, the seed of Abraham, all families of the earth shall be blessed. Verse 26, it says, to you first, God, having raised up his servant Jesus, sent him to bless you, in turning away every one of you from your sins. We have a sin problem. But God sent his son, so that he could turn every one of you from your sins. Amen? Amen? And it is because of Abraham's seed, all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Amen? Turn your Bibles to Galatians chapter 3. Try to just put this together. Now put this together. Abraham's seed, all families of the earth shall be blessed. But God raised up Jesus, a servant, that he may turn every one of you from your sin problem. In Galatians 3, chapter 7, the Bible says, therefore, know, this is what you're going to know. Therefore, you need to know that only those who are of faith are the sons of Abraham. How do you become a son of Abraham? Only those who are of faith are sons of Abraham. The Bible goes on in Galatians to say, and the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles by faith, preached the gospel to Abraham beforehand, saying, In you all, the nations shall be blessed. You read that. So then, those who are of faith are blessed with believing Abraham. You become part of Abraham's seed, even in 2015, you become part of Abraham's seed, and you shall be blessed. All nations are going to be blessed through Abraham. Amen? And you're going to be blessed. You're going to be part of his seed. You can be part of Abraham's seed through faith. Amen? Through faith. In Galatians chapter 3 and verse 26. Galatians chapter 3 and verse 26. Expound a little even more on this. For you are the sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. How do you become the seed of Abraham? Through faith. But that faith has got to come, what? In Christ Jesus. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ, the guy who was born in Bethlehem, for as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Therefore, there's neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are in Christ Jesus, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Isn't the presentation about redemption? Yeah. Didn't sin enter the world in the Garden of Eden? Yeah. But God had a plan that you, he promised that all nations shall be blessed by the seed of Abraham. Mm-hmm. And you can be part of that seed through faith. But the faith has got to be in Christ Jesus. And you had that faith when you are baptized. Well, you put on Christ Jesus when you are baptized into Christ Jesus. That's how you put them on, right? And therefore, you're neither Greek, Jew, you're not slave, you're not male, not female. All you are is one in Christ Jesus. And if you're in Christ Jesus, then automatically you are the seed of Abraham and heirs according to that same promise that was given to Abraham. Amen? Talking about the reason for the season, understanding that the Savior was born on a certain day years ago. It was an operation of God for our redemption. But even so, more today, 2015, that same Jesus, the Son of God, he did miracles, he did many things to fulfill righteousness. But the greatest part of his fulfillment of righteousness is that he died on the cross. Yeah. Remember when Abraham ran on the mount and the angel of the Lord told Abraham to sacrifice his only begotten son? The same like figure where God sent his only begotten son to die on the cross as that eternal sacrifice for your sin problem. That's how you get redeemed. And you can be redeemed today, even right now, if you obey the gospel, the good news of the gospel, that Jesus, that same Jesus that was born in Bethlehem, the Son of God, that he fulfilled all righteousness, even so to the death of the cross. And on the third day, he rose again, having victory over sin and death. Remember we read about the gates of hell? Jesus has the key even to the gates of hell. Hell can't even contain all those who obey the good news of the gospel. You can do that today by believing that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. In Hebrews chapter 6, 11 verse 6, it says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. Without faith, you can't get in Christ. If you're not in Christ, you don't have access to the seed of Abraham. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. In Romans 10:17, it says, faith cometh by hearing the word of God. You heard God's word. You want to know what faith is? Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1 says, faith is the substance of things hoped for, but it's the evidence. It's all this evidence of things not seen. You have enough evidence to have faith, right? Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 says, without faith, it is impossible to please him. He that cometh unto God must believe that he is God. And if you believe that he is God, it should cause something to happen in your heart. In your heart. It should cause you to say, hey, I need to stop living according to the world and start living according to God's word. Repent. And Luke chapter 13 and verse 3 said, I tell you now, except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. Amen. And if you start in your heart, start focusing on God, repenting, to cause you to have this thing in your heart to obey confession. In Matthew chapter 10 and verse 32 and 33, Jesus said, if you confess me before men, him will I confess before my Father, which is in heaven. Confess with your mouth what you believe in your heart. It's obedience unto God. Right? And then you complete your obedience by being baptized in water for the remission of your sins. Amen? Amen. Galatians chapter 3, I'll just read it again. Galatians chapter 3, as we're getting ready to sing our invitation song, it says, for you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus, right? For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. How do you put on Christ? By being baptized in water for the remission of your sins. Amen? As we stand at this time, we're singing the invitation song. And that's God's invitation to everyone to obey his gospel. And if you have a request for the church to pray on behalf of yourself or on behalf of others, you can come forward as we stand and sing.
Have you been to Jesus for the prayer?